Greetings fellow nerds. Every couple of years or so, I show another way to make sulfuric acid. It seems to have become a tradition at this point. In this video, we're going to do it by a rather unusual process, oxalic acid precipitation. I'll tell you up front, the yield was around 46%, and by overloading the reagents, as well as using unorthodox reducing agents, we can bump that up to 67%. So amateur viable, but since it uses a lot of ferrous sulfate and oxalic acid, it's very expensive compared to the sulfuric acid produced. So let's get started. First, we get 300 grams of iron 2 sulfate heptahydrate, also called ferrous sulfate heptahydrate. I bought mine as a gardening chemical. Then we dissolve that in 1 liter of water. You may need to gently heat it up to speed up the dissolution. While that is going, we get exactly half the mass of oxalic acid dihydrate, or 150 grams, and dissolve that in 300 milliliters of water. We heat the oxalic acid to dissolve it. Then once it's dissolved, we add that to the previous solution of iron sulfate. Oxalic acid has the rather interesting property that it forms insoluble oxalate salts with many metal ions. So if reacted with iron sulfate, it will produce insoluble iron oxalate. The sulfate ion is freed and becomes sulfuric acid. This is a rather unusual reaction because usually the reverse reaction is more favorable. Oxalic acid is a much weaker acid than sulfuric acid, and usually if you react a weak acid salt with a strong acid, you make the weak acid and the strong acid salt. And if you react a strong acid salt with a weak acid, like we are here, usually nothing happens. But in our case, the iron oxalate is so insoluble that it drives the reaction forward and we create the stronger sulfuric acid despite starting with a weaker acid. This doesn't work with other weak acids like acetic acid, so oxalic acid is quite unusual like that. Anyway, keep stirring until it cools and then let it settle. This is so that's easier for us to decant and filter it later. I find it much easier to decant and filter rather than filtering the slurry directly. The residue is iron oxalate and is useful in itself for making such interesting compounds like pyrophoric iron. So you can save it if you want, although it is very impure containing lots of unreacted oxalic acid. So keep that in mind. Meanwhile, our sulfuric acid is in the filtrate and I boiled it down until it started to crystallize. For my solution, this was around 200 milliliters. Then we let it cool. The unreacted iron sulfate is much less soluble in the sulfuric acid solution, so it crystallizes out. We then decant that into a new flask, and you can see here the iron sulfate. We need to remove this so it won't bump when we distill the sulfuric acid. So now we set up a sulfuric acid distillation system and distill our sulfuric acid. For further information on how to distill sulfuric acid, refer to my previous video on sulfuric acid purification. Links are in the video description. I will add though that boiling oxalic acid with sulfuric acid produces small amounts of carbon monoxide. So this distillation must be performed outside under a fume hood. You should still be doing that anyway when distilling sulfuric acid, but I thought I should mention that. I kept checking the density of the distillate as it came off, and when the density was above that of water, I start collecting the sulfuric acid. And there it is, about 70 grams of diluted sulfuric acid. To find the concentration, we do a density check and I got 1.61 grams, which gives us a concentration of about 70% for this temperature. So our 70 grams of dilute acid contains 49 grams of actual sulfuric acid. The expected yield was about 105.7 grams, so our yield was 46%. So the yield isn't terrible, but considering we had to process 450 grams worth of chemicals just to get a tiny amount of acid, I don't think it's viable overall. But I'll leave that choice up to you. The yield isn't high, primarily because the reaction doesn't go to completion. As said before, reacting a strong acid with a weak acid salt tends to produce the weak acid and strong acid salt. So as sulfuric acid builds up, it reacts with the iron oxalate and converts it back to iron sulfate and oxalic acid. You can push the reaction forward somewhat by diluting the chemicals with even more water to reduce the overall concentration of sulfuric acid. I couldn't do that because I was limited by my glassware. But one thing we can do is use a much greater access of reagents. So I tried again, but this time I used 200 grams of oxalic acid rather than 150 grams. This much greater access of oxalic acid pushes the reaction forward again, and after doing the subsequent distilling and filtering, I was able to get about 57% yield of sulfuric acid with the display parameters. So this process can be optimized. Another contributor to the reduced yield was the oxidation of iron 2 ions to iron 3 ions by the oxygen in the air. You can clearly see this as this yellow-brown color of the iron sulfate when pure iron 2 sulfate should be green. The resulting iron 3 oxalate is somewhat more soluble, especially under these acidic conditions. Some amateurs improved their yield considerably by adding a reducing agent like ascorbic acid or bubbling in sulfur dioxide. Perhaps I'll try that in the future. But instead I'm going to redo the experiment and try a different reducing agent. I'm going to use
a nice summer's day and the full concentrated power of the sun!
I'm not joking. I've redone the experiment with the exact same proportions as earlier with the 200 grams of oxalic acid, and before I filtered the iron oxalate, I left the beaker in direct sunlight for 8 hours. What's happening is that the iron 3 oxalate is actually photosensitive and photodecomposes into iron 2 oxalate and carbon dioxide. This is actually a well-known reaction and used for some types of early photography before the development of more advanced silver halide-based processes. A great benefit for us is that it's clean and the resulting carbon dioxide easily boils out. Anyway, after 8 hours in the sun, I brought it inside, filtered it and boiled it down, distilled it, and was able to obtain 67% yield. I'm actually impressed that simply leaving it out in the sun creates such a big yield improvement. Maybe if I left it out for a week I'd get even better yield, but I'll leave those experiments to someone else who isn't as lazy. So I hope that video was useful to you. Before I go, I'm also going to look at a similar process of using magnesium sulfate rather than iron sulfate. I'll tell you up front that it failed and only gave 2% yield, so feel free to stop the video now, or watch me analyze why it failed. Magnesium sulfate and oxalic acid is talked about a lot in online chemistry message boards and sounds like a cheaper alternative to iron sulfate, but there are conflicting reports of its viability. So I made my own experiment using 500 grams of magnesium sulfate heptahydrate in a liter of water and 300 grams of oxalic acid in 500 milliliters. After boiling them and mixing them together, I got a precipitate and I thought it was working. So I filtered them, boiled them down, and then proceeded to distill the acid. The final amount I obtained was 25 grams at a density of 1.1 grams for a concentration of about 15%, or about 3.75 grams of actual yield. I was expecting 200 grams or so, and so the yield was under 2%. 2% is completely useless for the amateur. You might as well spend the same money buying copper sulfate and electrolyzing it, the previously most expensive way of making sulfuric acid. At least this magnesium oxalate process now gains that title. It seems this process failed because the magnesium oxalate formed just wasn't stable enough to drive the reaction forward. So the sulfuric acid produced simply reacted with the magnesium oxalate and drove it back again. But I can understand why so many amateur chemists were fooled. They weren't lying, they were just misinterpreting their results. If you look at the distillation, you can see a massive amount of magnesium sulfate residue in the boiling flask. What I think happened was amateur chemists that tried this measured the density of their filtrate and found it was much higher than water, and so assumed it was sulfuric acid, not realizing it was just dissolved magnesium sulfate. This belief suffered further confirmation bias when they saw the precipitation during the initial mixing. This precipitation contains some magnesium oxalate, but actually it's mostly oxalic acid cooling and crystallizing back out. Anyway, the small amount of sulfuric acid that was produced, as well as dissolved oxalic acid, gave an acid indication to pH testing. So the bias was confirmed and those chemists declared this method successful. I don't think they were, but I don't think they were lying. Distilling sulfuric acid to test it is extremely dangerous and difficult, and I don't blame them for not trying it. It's really hard to be an amateur chemist, and I myself have made countless mistakes, biased conclusions, and supremely ignorant theories. Finally, I want to explore the use of copper sulfate. Copper sulfate is also pretty easy to get, although it's somewhat more expensive than iron sulfate. Nonetheless, it also forms insoluble oxalates, so it's worth trying out. There are some reports on chemistry message boards claiming that it was superior to iron sulfate. So I prepared a mixture consisting of 250 grams of copper sulfate and 150 grams of oxalic acid in a total of 1.5 liters of water. Interestingly enough, it did work and it seemed to produce the proper precipitate of copper oxalate. Unfortunately, when I tried to filter it, the copper oxalate was so fine that it passed right through. It's like trying to filter milk. Although it looks closer to Star Wars blue milk that Luke Skywalker drinks. Anyway, even letting it sit for a day to settle didn't help much. I also tried boiling mixture to induce Ostwald ripening, but that didn't work either. I added excess copper sulfate because maybe you need excess copper to get the particles to stick. Finally, I tried adding 10 grams of iron sulfate to act as a flocculating agent, but that also turned up nothing. This is disappointing because the process does seem to work. The minor amount of solution that did separate was almost clear, indicating the copper ions were indeed mostly removed. Without a way to separate the copper oxalate from the supernatant, it doesn't seem viable. Nonetheless, I'm probably doing something wrong. Various other amateurs report success, so maybe there is some small difference in impurities between their chemicals and mine that allows for separation. But overall, I would still use the electrolytic method to convert copper sulfate into sulfuric acid since it's cheaper than oxalic acid. So thanks for watching. If you like the video, please subscribe, like, and comment. I know some of you will ask if this method can work for nitric acid. Actually, it does. And I'm currently working on a video for that, so please subscribe to stay informed. If you really like my content, then consider becoming a Patreon member where you get video previews of works in progress. Alternatively, one-time donations with YouTube Super Thanks is greatly appreciated.